Now I will introduce tonight's speaker. I have the distinct privilege of working with Dr. Sapna Syngal. Sapna came to Dana-Farber in 1993, where she trained under the luminary and hereditary cancer genetics, Dr. Fred Lee. Throughout her career, she has been a compassionate doctor treating patients and families with inherited cancer risk, and through her research, has bolstered Dana-Farber's leadership position in the field. She helped launch the Center for Cancer Genetics and Prevention, the first of its kind in the country, for which she is now director of research. She founded the Lynch Syndrome Center, is co-leader of the Cancer Risk Prevention and Early Detection Program for the entire Dana-Farber Harvard Cancer Center, and helps train future generations as professor of Harvard Medical School. Sapna has been internationally recognized for her research discoveries, most notably for the development of an algorithm for inherited cancer risk assessment and a virtual genetic testing program, all of which you will hear more about. In addition to all this, Sapna is the proud mother of three daughters and enjoys spending her time in Los Angeles. For those in the audience who haven't had the opportunity to meet Sapna, we thought you would appreciate hearing from one of her patients, Carol Bowen, a patient advocate and supporter, and I know Carol's also in the audience, so thanks for joining us tonight. Carol graciously shared her personal story of how cancer impacted her family at a previous Dana-Farber event. At the beginning of the clip, which we're not showing, she shares that six members of her family tragically died of pancreatic cancer, and many others in her family have had other types of cancer. Carol shares this to highlight why she decided to take a proactive approach to cancer and see Dr. Syngal at Dana-Farber. Her moving remarks are an example of the great impact Dr. Syngal has had on patients like Carol and emphasize why her work is vital in the fight against cancer. We'll let Carol share the rest of her story in her own words.
Pancreatic cancer is rare under age 50, so when I reached my 50s, I decided to seek a proactive approach based on my family history. My mom had participated in the early CAPS, or cancer of pancreas screening studies, at Johns Hopkins, which resulted in that prevention protocol that I mentioned. But I live in the Boston area, and researching online quickly led me to Dana-Farber as the place to go, and to the wonderful Dr. Sapna Syngal. She's the director of research at the Center for Cancer Genetics and Prevention. When I first met her, I felt an instant rapport. She was just what I was looking for in my quest to prevent pancreatic cancer. Someone with extensive knowledge and interest in pancreatic cancer and cancer families, as well as a deep personal warmth. She answered all of my questions and she spent as much time with me as I needed, and it was really refreshing. She clearly has deep respect for her patients and approaches them as colleagues, or maybe I should say fellow soldiers in this war. So now I have the appropriate procedures every year and I'm fine, and I sure hope to stay that way. But unfortunately, pancreatic cancer did strike my own immediate family. My husband Les and I had long tried to take steps to prevent cancer in general, never smoking, exercising, eating a healthy diet, keeping our weight down, everything that you probably do too. By 2012, life was going well for the two of us. Our daughters were out of college, their careers launched, our businesses were doing well, and we were traveling and having fun. Early that year, Les had some stomach aches on and off, but nothing that seemed out of the ordinary. Finally, his doctor suggested an endoscopy to see what was going on, and it turned out that his stomach was just fine. But imagine our shock and our horror when, out of the blue, he was diagnosed with all things of stage 4 pancreatic cancer. He was truly the healthiest person I've ever known and a wonderful guy. Les received terrific treatment at Emerson Hospital in Concord, Massachusetts, and at Dana-Farber with the wonderful Dr. Peter Enzinger. And he got the latest extremely toxic chemotherapy, which he really tolerated well. He fought valiantly. But tragically, 4.5 months after being diagnosed and just a few months after his 60th birthday, Les died. After his death in 2012, I ran both his company and my own for a few years, and it was pretty crazy, as you can imagine. But in the quiet evenings, I thought long and hard about pancreatic cancer and what my daughters and I could do to help change the outcome of this horrific disease. As I mentioned, we were already seeking the support of Dana-Farber to help prevent cancer with early screening protocols. But I wanted to go further, and I concluded that developing even better prevention tools would offer the best hope for survival or even cure for members of my family and other individuals who are part of cancer families. And like all of you, I decided to support Dana-Farber, an extraordinary institution. I spoke with Sapna Syngal, and she told me that she and some colleagues were developing a research initiative focused on genetic susceptibility to pancreatic cancer called GENERATE, or Genetic Education, Risk Assessment, and Testing. I'm now funding her research looking at people who have a relative with pancreatic cancer that may be caused by an inherited gene mutation. Their study aims to teach these individuals about their risk of pancreatic cancer, educate them about genetic testing and its benefits, and then hopefully have them complete genetic testing through a simple blood test. Those who have a known gene mutation can be enrolled in protocols like the one I'm in with the goal of preventing pancreatic cancer. It's clear to me that genetics, early screening, and prevention are the future in the fight against cancer. Dana-Farber has long been a leader in this area, starting with the development of one of the first clinical genetics and prevention programs in the world from the seminal work of Dana-Farber physician, Dr. Frederick Lee. Remember when I said we felt helpless and powerless when cancer, that horrible family member, shows up one day? I'm supporting genetics and prevention research at Dana-Farber because I firmly believe the outcomes will give pancreatic and other cancer patients hope, and more importantly, a better possibility of survival. Someday, those of us in cancer families will be able to slam the door in cancer's face and walk away healthy and strong. I look forward to that day, as I know we all do. Thank you for letting me share my story, and thank you for your continued support of Dana-Farber.
Can everybody see my slides? Yes? Okay.
Yes.
Okay, thank you, Carol. That was incredible. I really had not seen that video till just a few days ago, and I'm so touched by it and your support of us, of course. And I wanna thank everybody who's come here tonight to hear about our work, and many of my former patients and supporters are also here in addition to Carol. So we really all appreciate your involvement tonight. So this is going to be an overview of the presentation, and I think Carol has set us up beautifully for this, better than I could have. I'm going to go over Dana-Farber's strategic plan. I'm going to talk a little bit about genetics and prevention just to orient everybody about what we're talking about in terms of inherited cancers. And then I'm going to present the two research projects that were already mentioned, one by Angel, which is a risk assessment tool for hereditary cancer assessment that we've developed. And the second is the GENERATE study that Carol mentioned, which is focused on families with pancreatic cancer. I'm going to also discuss a really novel center that we've launched in the last year, again, with support from people in this audience, called the Lynch Syndrome Center. And then finally, I'm going to review where the Dana-Farber Harvard Cancer Center is going in this whole space. So I hope you will be at the end as excited as I am about this work. I'm going to do just one thing to get these so I can see my slides. Perfect. So the Dana-Farber's strategic plan seeks to accelerate our success by leading the field in discovery and innovation, providing the best outcomes for more patients, and investing in talent and resources. And we do this all under the umbrella of inclusion, diversity, and equity. We really want all the discoveries that happen at Dana-Farber to be available to everybody around the country and also around the world. These are the key research initiatives of the strategic plan, and I really want to applaud our president and CEO, Dr. Lori Glimcher, for coming up with the strategic plan with other investigators and leaders at Dana-Farber. And these are the five pillars, and what I'm going to do is focus on this one, which is precision prevention and detection. And the whole idea is to focus a whole area of work on finding and intercepting cancer at its earliest stages. And I'm going to define interception a little bit because it's a new term that's come up in the last few years. We talked about a lot about prevention in the early days of sort of thinking about moving up the timeline of cancer care. And I think that we all know, as Carol mentioned, is about exercising, diet, other things that you can do to prevent cancer. Interception is another term of actually finding cancer at its earliest stages. And that's really effective because we really know that if you can pick up cancer at its early stages, you can really dramatically change the mortality from the disease. So my story at Dana-Farber, as Angel mentioned, started early, a long time ago now, shortly after this paper was published by investigators at Dana-Farber, that are some of whom are listed here, Fred Lee, Dr. Judy Garber, and Richard Kolodner. And this was the discovery of the first gene associated with a phenomenon known as Lynch syndrome. These are patients who have elevated risks of cancer. And we knew that there were families like this that had been around since the 1800s. But there was never a genetic cause that was described. And this paper in 1993 really established that. This was also the same time around that the BRCA1 and BRCA2 genes, BRCA as we know them, were also described for hereditary breast cancer. And I came to Dana-Farber looking for a research project. The three daughters that Angel mentioned were not born yet. And I had always wanted to work in the cancer field since medical school. But what I realized in my residency was that as I took care of cancer patients, that it often seemed like we were acting too late. And I wanted to focus early when we could really have a profound impact. And what Fred, Judy, and Richard told me that afternoon was that they had published this paper, they had started collecting some families who were affected by Lynch syndrome, but really that there wasn't a real program devoted to this, and would I be interested? And really, I really didn't know how much at the beginning of the field we were, and I probably didn't even know how big the luminaries that I was speaking with were, but it's really been an amazing career that these three have mentored or started the mentorship for me. So to review genetics of cancer, most cancer is what we call sporadic. 70 to 80% of cancers don't have an inherited cause. They occur during somebody's lifetime. They're probably due to some components of diet, environment, and a lot of other factors that we don't really still understand. Smoking, of course, and other risk factors. There's another 15 to 20% of cases that are familial. And many of you, I'm sure, unfortunately, have family members who have developed cancer. That doesn't necessarily mean that there is a gene mutation that's tracking within your family. This, what we call moderate risk increase, is a little bit increased above the general population, but not dramatically. And about 5 to 10% of cancers are so-called inherited cancers or hereditary cancers. And that's where a single gene mutation is inherited in a patient. It puts them at increased risk to develop cancer, which they do later on in their lifetime. These are also sobering statistics on the right part of the box, that one third of us at some point in our lives are going to get cancer. And a lot of people say that if you live long enough and you don't die of heart disease or other chronic disease, at some point, many of us are going to develop cancer later on in life. As I said, up to 10% of all cancers are caused by germline mutations. But early identification of these 10 million mutation carriers can really intercept cancer development. So the whole idea about this is let's figure out risk and then intervene on these patients and these individuals so we don't develop cancer later on in our life. So Lynch syndrome was where I started, as I mentioned, and the field has really transformed in the last 25 years since the gene was discovered. We now know that about 1 in 300 individuals in the United States and around the world carry a mutation that's associated with Lynch syndrome. Their cancer risks are here on the right part of the box, 12-fold increase in colorectal cancer, 15-fold increase in uterine cancer, and other, several other cancers are associated as well, including stomach cancer and ovarian cancer. What we also know is that cancer screening can dramatically reduce incidence. That means the number of people who develop cancer in their lifetime, as well as the mortality. Some of these patients may need prophylactic surgery, and this is really generally reserved for the uterus for and ovaries, for which we don't have great screening tests available right now, and done, you know, in the late mid to late 40s after childbearing is complete. But we really can alter people's outcomes with Lynch syndrome if we diagnose them. But the challenges facing Lynch syndrome patients is that the diagnosis requires putting together histories of multiple types of cancer. And as you know, we live in a very highly specialized world. So a woman may be seeing her gynecologist who asks about an ovarian cancer history or uterine cancer, but does not think to inquire about colorectal cancer. And the same thing, somebody may pick up a cancer history of colon cancer, but not ask about the other component tumors. Family history to do it properly takes a long time to obtain. And providers often don't know when to refer a patient for genetic testing because the field is changing so rapidly. So it's really hard for the average primary care doctor or even oncologist to keep abreast with, you know, how to diagnose these patients and when to refer them. So we, about 15 years ago, developed something called PREM, which is stands for prediction of multiple mutations, as a potential solution for all this. We started with Lynch syndrome, and basically the idea is we collaborated with a genetic testing company that had thousands of patients who'd undergone genetic testing for Lynch syndrome. And we developed a complex algorithm. So it's basically a very complicated formula that takes into account somebody's personal cancer history, as well as their family history. But it translates this into a very simple questionnaire that takes about 5 minutes to complete and spits out a number that tells the doctor when the patient should be referred for genetic testing. And many years ago, this was, you know, before we were so like routinely using the internet for medical care, we decided to, when the paper was published, to put this algorithm on the Dana-Farber website. And that's where it's lived. And it's really changed, I think, risk assessment for Lynch syndrome, because physicians not only at Dana-Farber, but all around the world use PREM as a way to figure out who has Lynch syndrome and who should be referred for genetic testing. We also, Dana-Farber developed intellectual property around this algorithm and around PREM. So we have the ability to actually license this to other providers and other users. What we're working on now is expanding the PREM to something that we're calling PREM Plus, which is going to evaluate for all hereditary cancers. And this is about to be submitted for publication in the next few months. And this is going to be the same idea, that it's going to be an easy way to get family history, but the model will predict whether you have a higher chance of having a BRCA mutation or a Lynch syndrome mutation, or any of these new genes that have come up in the last 10 or so years. And again, you could imagine that for a physician, to keep track of all these is really complicated. So we're hoping that PREM Plus will make this much easier. In the future, what we're doing is developing a patient-facing app. So Leslie Solomon, who is the head of our innovations office, envisioned something that where we can have this kind of algorithm available to patients, perhaps on a cereal box, where they can, you know, sort of put that app in their phone and fill out their family history and see if this is something that they should be concerned about. We're also engaging in licensing the technology for diverse use with hospital systems, primary care providers. And I think what's really going to change it is if we can embed this into the electronic medical records that physicians use around the country. So you can imagine the idea would be that before you go to see your doctor, they will send you a link to fill out a family history. It will calculate your PREM score. And by the time you go in to see them, they will know whether a genetics consult is indicated for you. And we're actually piloting this right now at Dana-Farber. And so the idea here is we would like to impact cancer prevention by making risk assessment part of routine care. So everybody who's in the audience, you know, I think the take home of this part of the presentation is, you know, make sure, think back about your family history, Ask your family members. A lot of people have not talked about this. And in fact, the Surgeon General many years ago called Thanksgiving, Family Cancer History Day, as a time where people can actually talk to their families and know each other's histories and make sure that the pieces have been put together if they need to be. Now, the next step, though, is once you find a mutation, is how do we actually communicate this information to family members who are healthy who need to know it. We've focused on this in the area of pancreatic cancer. This is Generate, the study that Carol mentioned in her presentation. And what we know, unfortunately, is so true, Carol's husband's story, is that most people with pancreatic cancer do not survive beyond 1 to 3 years. And what we've learned in the last 10 years or so is that, again, about 10% of pancreatic cancer cases carry inherited mutations that have increased that individual's risk for pancreatic cancer. And because it's so hard to diagnose pancreatic cancer at early stages, in the last 3 years, national guidelines now recommend that all pancreatic cancer patients undergo genetic testing. So you don't even have to get a family history. As soon as you have a pancreatic cancer diagnosis, that individual should undergo genetic testing to see if they carry one of these genes. Now, the problem is once you find a mutation, you need to communicate it to the rest of the family. And basically, this right chart part, the chart on the right side shows that this was a study actually not in pancreas cancer, but in BRCA mutation carriers that looked at who people told once they knew that they carried a mutation. And what the study showed was women told their husbands, they told their sisters, but then it really dropped off. They didn't tell more distant relatives. They were less likely to tell the men in their family, so their brothers or their sons. And this is actually a misconception, because while it's true that men are, you know, are not going to get ovarian cancer and have a much lower risk of getting breast cancer, although there's a small risk, they are at risk of transmitting that gene mutation to their daughters. So it's actually very important information that they need to have. In addition, you know, not everybody has Dana-Farber in their backyard or a major cancer center. So there's a real lack of access to specialists who know about this. There's currently geographical needs. So the traditional model is you needed to go in to see your doctor for an in-person visit. There's obviously cost, and there's the reliance of the patient to be the communicator. And many people are not really comfortable doing that routinely. So the other piece of this that's happened in parallel. So I've talked to you a lot about the medical part of genetic testing. As all of you know, genetic testing in the lay community has, you know, really taken off. And this has not been for cancer, but ancestry.com is really sparked a lot of interest in people knowing about their ancestry. And what we know is that people are perfectly willing to send a saliva sample, spit into a kit, send it to a company and get the test results sent to them. And it's really been a model that we've been intrigued by. The company 23andMe tried to do cancer testing, but their cancer testing, genetic testing is quite limited. So there really wasn't somebody doing this on a remote basis till recently, when Color Genomics was a company that sort of broke open the field and allowed remote genetic testing to happen with the assistance of a physician ordering the test. So this led us to put together the Generate team. This is a research project that's really ambitious, includes multiple cancer centers and really leading groups around the country, including Mayo Clinic, MD Anderson Cancer Center, Johns Hopkins, UC San Diego. And we are leading the Generate study for this team. This is funded by Stand Up to Cancer and the Lusgarten Foundation, who we're very grateful to. And of course, generous donors like Carol. And what the goal of the Generate study is to actually allow patients, I'm going to actually go here, allow patients to get genetic testing from the comfort of their homes. And what we said was that if you have a family member with pancreatic cancer who's diagnosed with a mutation, their family members can contact the study online, consent online, and if they're eligible, get a saliva kit shipped to their home, send the genetic test to Color Genomics, and get the education and counseling that they need remotely by logging on to a portal that's private and with the assistance of counselors who are part of the Dana-Farber Cancer Team. So we really thought this was a way to sort of alleviate a lot of the barriers that I mentioned to you earlier. And it was going relatively well. We were a year into the study in early 2020, but we were hitting a snag of lower than anticipated enrollment because despite those recommendations that I told you about that say that all pancreas cancer patients still should get genetic testing, the vast majority of pancreatic cancer patients were in fact not getting genetic testing. And we can imagine, I've talked to you about some of the reasons that this happens. But another one is that, you know, when there's a new diagnosis of cancer, understandably people, the patients, their families and their physicians are really concerned about taking care of that patient's cancer. And the things like genetic testing and taking care of the family fall lower on the priority list. And in pancreas cancer, we don't have that much time to get back to the genetic testing aspects. There was also, of course, the COVID pandemic. And this was interesting. A lot of research, as you probably have heard, was stalled because of the COVID pandemic. People couldn't go into the hospital. They couldn't get their research procedures that they needed. And we were lucky that the entire GENERATE study was conducted and was designed to be completely online. So paradoxically, the COVID pandemic, we didn't skip a beat because of it. And in fact, many patients were interested in GENERATE because they couldn't get to their doctors to get their testing, and the study allowed them to get testing. We also had low enrollment of underrepresented minorities. So there are a couple of things that we did is that in May 2020, so this was 3 months into the pandemic, we expanded the eligibility criteria to include people who had a family history of pancreatic cancer. So this meant that you no longer needed to have an identified gene mutation. You just had to have a first degree family member. So a parent, a child, a brother or a sister who had developed pancreas cancer. And we opened, we expanded this criteria, and all of a sudden the floodgates opened. You know, we have enrolled in less than a year, 640 people since that time. In the year before, we had enrolled 100 people. So despite COVID, 600 people have been interested in this testing, and 350 patients have received their genetic test results. So this really shows, I think, to me that there's a real interest in having this information. People are concerned when they have a family history of cancer, and they're willing to undergo genetic testing as long as we make it easier for them to get the education they need and get the testing. Now, in terms of the racial inequities, when we went, we had very low enrollment of Black and Hispanic individuals in the study, and this is obviously something that all of us are very sensitive to. We started to talk to the community leaders, and what we heard was what we've heard about, you know, the COVID as well, is that there are systemic issues in our healthcare system that actually affect why minorities can't enroll and can't participate in healthcare in the ways that Caucasians can. And what they told us also, as we've heard with COVID, is that these solutions to this are not simple. So we've actually decided to do a whole new program that's going to address racial and ethnic equity in genetic education. And there's a lot of distrust actually from the communities about genetic testing that go back a long way. And this is going to be a longstanding program that we're launching now. And the lead person, this is Nicolette Rodriguez, who's a terrific GI fellow. So she's a trainee, but has been interested in this since her medical school days. And this is other members of the team who are going to work on this. Now, how will genetic testing lead to pancreatic cancer interception? So this is a question I get all the time. Why would anybody want to know that they have a gene for something that's so lethal? Well, like with Lynch syndrome, screening actually impacts pancreatic cancer outcomes. There's now data that say that if you screen BRCA mutation carriers who have an elevated risk of pancreas cancer or other individuals who have an increased risk with MRIs or endoscopic ultrasounds, you can pick up pancreatic cancer early, just like our hope was, and you can decrease mortality from pancreatic cancer because of that shift in staging. You can also pick up lesions that are pre-malignant. So there are people that we have sent for surgery of just that lesion that were almost turning into pancreatic cancer. So that's truly prevention. What this group is going to do, though, is take it one step further. And we're working, again, with all those investigators in the institutions that I mentioned earlier to develop a new screening protocol that's using artificial intelligence to read MRI and CAT scan images to improve the accuracy of imaging. The investigators at Johns Hopkins are leading the efforts to develop a vaccine against pancreatic cancer. And actually, just in the last few weeks, we had a meeting where the protocol has been submitted, and we're going to start enrolling at Johns Hopkins first, and then in a multi-center way, individuals who have gene mutations who can be enrolled in a trial as for a vaccine with the hopes of preventing pancreas cancer. Now, again, of course, this is very early in the game and we're evaluating things like safety, but I'll remind you that we have an effective vaccine for cervical cancer. So it seemed very, out of the box when we started talking about it, but it really is a possibility. And this is true for Lynch syndrome and other cancers as well. So I think this is a whole very exciting area of research in terms of prevention of cancer. The other thing that we're going to do is collect specimens from serum, blood, plasma, urine to look for new blood markers that hopefully will give us non-invasive ways of detecting pancreatic cancer. So what I hope I've sort of shown you is that this is a multifaceted approach to intercept pancreatic cancer in high-risk patients. Now, I'm going to sort of go back to the beginning where we started. When I had that meeting with Judy and Fred and Richard, the genes had just gotten identified. And as Angel mentioned, Judy and I started seeing patients. And we, started a clinic that would, Judy saw breast and ovarian cancer patients and leaf romani patients. I started the GI program. It was just the two of us. And we would often, the genetic testing was not available commercially. We had to get research testing. And this has really transformed in the last 25 years. Now there are multiple laboratories that offer testing. Our center now staffs 12 physicians, 2 nurse practitioners. We have 19 genetic counselors and a big research program. In 2020, we saw almost 8,000 patients, and the volumes of patients who are coming to the center increase consistently every year. So it's really been remarkable to see how the field has changed and how we're able to help people, get through their risk and deal with their risk as part of their routine clinical care. As part of this, what we're also launching are novel models for providing integrative care. So this is the Lynch Syndrome Center that we launched in March 2019. This is the first Lynch Center of its kind around the world that completely targets and is focused on the care of patients with Lynch syndrome. And we have a whole team of individuals, of physicians, of nurses, of psychologists who are really in tune with what the novel strategies are for caring of these patients as well as the research. And the idea is that your care starts not when you get cancer, but when you find that you have the risk for cancer. And the hope is that we will prevent cancer successfully in the vast majority of these patients. So this is really exciting, and there are multiple initiatives like this in Dana-Farber, including a center for BRCA and related genes. There's a leaf romani syndrome center, and in our heme, with our heme colleagues, there's a center for prevention of blood cancers, as well as something called the PROMISE study, which is looking to do prevention, early interception of myeloma, multiple myeloma precursors. So again, there's a real kind of momentum going at Dana-Farber about these prevention approaches. And the whole idea, I think, is that there's going to be a research infrastructure behind this as well. So once we get a new patient that has a diagnosis, we will consent them to research. Most people who come from families like this are very interested in participating in research, so it's not usually a problem to get them to participate. We collect patient information, including their clinical histories, but also plan to collect their diet, their exercise, their other health behaviors, their screening behaviors. We will collect samples, like I mentioned before, and then this will be a research infrastructure that evolves over time, fuels more discovery, and ultimately the goal is that, as I said, there's no reason that all the resources that we have at Dana-Farber, the knowledge, the discoveries, should not be made available to people around the country and even around the world. So finally, just the last two slides, I think I've presented to you what we're doing at Dana-Farber. This is also going on across the entire Harvard Cancer Center. So the Harvard Cancer Center encompasses not only Dana-Farber, but all our sister institutions, including Brigham Medical, the Beth Israel Deaconess, Harvard School of Public Health, et cetera. And there have been multiple programs that have been around for many years that encompass the programs. In the last year, there's been a new program that's launched, the first in almost 20 years, called the Cancer Risk Prevention and Early Detection Program, which I'm honored to lead with my co-leaders, Alicia Sequist and Gary Tierney at Mass General. And again, this is a program that's going to bring together all of these neighboring institutions to focus around the whole area of cancer prevention and interception. And we're talking not only the clinical hospitals, but also the Koch Institute for Research at MIT, the Harvard School of Engineering, the medical school, et cetera. And the idea is that we want to bring engineers who are discovering new technologies, new approaches, and put them together with doctors and researchers and public health scientists to actually look at this in an organized and cohesive way. So this is the last slide. You know, our program mission, both at Dana-Farber and across the Harvard Cancer Center, is to kind of disrupt some of the thinking around cancer. You know, we've had such remarkable progress in treatment, in biology, and understanding why cancer occurs. I think we haven't focused nearly enough in this whole field of understanding risk, acting on the risk to prevent cancer, and hopefully detect it early for the individuals who actually develop cancer. And I think the whole idea is that we want to focus a whole broad array of research around this critical period of cancer initiation and early growth. That's my presentation. I hope you're excited, and I really have tremendous enthusiasm for what we're doing and where we're going in this field. Thank you very much, and I'll turn it over back to Angel.
Thank you so much, Sapna, for that wonderful and informative overview. Your work always inspires me. I hope others in the audience felt similarly and felt like they learned something. Of course, I'll just say that philanthropy has been critical to getting many of these initiatives off the ground. And I just want to personally thank those in the audience who have supported this work and all of you who have supported Dana-Farber. Thank you so much. It's so critical to this work. I will also make a plug for our next Behind the Breakthroughs series webinar on the Center for Cancer Therapeutic Innovation featuring Dr. Lena Gandhi on March 18th. But of course, we want to hear from you all. We would love to invite you to ask your questions. And we would love for you to ask your questions on camera. It's great to see all these faces and to see you all joining us this evening. So if you look at the bottom of your Zoom screen, you'll see a button that says participants. And if you click that, you'll see a list of participant names on the right-hand side of your screen. And you can click the little hand next to your name, which will allow you to raise your hand, and we'll call on those of you who would like to ask a question and invite you to do so. For those of you not on camera, feel free to type your question in the chat, which is also a button at the bottom of your Zoom screen. So to kick things off, I will just ask one question that's already come through in the chat during the presentation, which was from Lydia. And it was specific to PALB2, which is a gene mutation. But I wanted to broaden the question a bit to make it relevant for everyone. So the question was, for someone who has a PALB2 mutation, no family history of pancreatic cancer and has not had cancer themselves, what kind of intervention screening methods can you do, such as endoscopy, and how frequently should you do these? And I'll broaden it to how frequently should you be doing the screening interventions that are available to us, even though there are very few, when you have a family history of cancer?
So that's a very broad question, but I'll start with a PALB2 question. And this is true for BRCA families as well, is that right now, if you don't have a family history of pancreatic cancer, even if you have the mutation, the risk is not high enough that you should be undergoing screening. And I played up the benefits of screening. I didn't talk about the downsides of screening is, you know, that there are risks to these procedures. They're invasive. And I think more importantly often, or more commonly, is that they lead to a lot of anxiety. So a lot of patients who have these screening procedures, you know, have to go to get the test, they wait for results, and sometimes we get false positive results. So we're very careful about making sure that we don't overscreen people. And so right now for PALB2, if you don't have a family history of pancreas cancer, I would say, don't do anything except for the things that we know, which is maintain a healthy body weight, exercise, have a low fat diet that's low in red meat and low in other sort of things that we know are unhealthy. Don't smoke, which is a huge risk factor for pancreatic cancer. But things will change. I think, 5 years down the road, we are probably going to have very many different screening tests, and that may be more appealing to offer to more of the general population or to PALB mutation carriers without a family history. In answer to your question, Angela, about the frequency for pancreas cancer, for people who need screening, we usually do something annually. So we generally do an endoscopic ultrasound 1 year in our program and then alternate with an MRI with the second year. If something is found, those may be done more frequently, but that's generally the approach. And that's part of these integrative centers, is that every, gene has a different screening algorithm, right? Has different frequencies, and you need to kind of know which ones are appropriate for that particular patient.
Thank you. To stay on the topic of screening, we had a question from Jane about the screening process for ovarian cancer and your thoughts on the CA125 test.
Yeah. CA125, we all wish that it was a great test, because, wouldn't it be wonderful to have a blood test that would pick up ovarian cancer? And unfortunately, it's not a great test. It picks up as many false positives. So you'll have a CA125 that's high when there's no cancer, or the false negatives. So somebody with ovarian cancer will have a normal CA125. So we don't actually, in our program, offer it because it causes more problems often than it solves. But there are other centers who use it more routinely. Again, there's a lot of work in developing new ovarian cancer tools that are happening at Dana-Farber and elsewhere. The big ones are, the circulating tumor markers. So you probably have heard there's a lot of interest and a lot of work being done at picking up the earliest stages of changes in cells that are transmitted into the blood system. And there are multiple companies who are working on this. There are multiple investigators. I think that may be the wave of the future of circulating markers. And the other piece is that we hope that the imaging, radiology will get better again over the upcoming years. So unfortunately, I don't have a great answer for an available screening test right now for ovarian cancer.
Another question that was previously submitted is there a hereditary genetic component to cancer of the small intestine?
There is, but again, the same thing, about, I would say 5 to 10% of individuals. Cancer of the small intestine is incredibly rare. And actually, when you develop a very rare cancer, that increases your chances of having a genetic cause for it, So I would say if you have had a small intestinal cancer, especially if you're young, meaning, under 60, let's say, I would talk to your doctor about the potential of at least doing some form of genetic evaluation.
which actually fits nicely with another question submitted by Richard, which is, how do you figure out who's eligible for genetic testing? Specifically, he mentioned pancreatic cancer, testing for a family history of pancreatic cancer, but I'm sure, you know, people have other cancer histories in their family.
Yeah. You know, I think that, like I said, it's we're developing a way to do it in a way that's going to be helpful routinely for across cancers. Right now, it's different for each of the cancers. There's different clinical criteria. The two that are everybody should be getting tested for is are ovarian and pancreatic cancer. So that there's enough risk and that there's consensus that anybody who develops one of those two cancers should get genetic testing. For the others, what I would sort of say is remember these kind of basic principles that we used to use for a long time, which is if there's anybody who's diagnosed young in the family with a cancer, you should think about genetic testing. If there are multiple family members, which means usually two or more with the same type of cancer, you should be thinking about genetic testing. And honestly, I think in today's day and age, if you have, and it's usually in the same side of the family, that's the other thing, is that people often add up their mother's side and their father's side, and the genes are usually, for the most part, transmitted from one side of the family or the other. So look at each side individually, but if in one side of the family, it seems like there's more cancer than you would expect, then it's perfectly appropriate to talk to your doctor about getting a referral for genetic testing. And we these days have a very low threshold because we've learned that we often can't predict who carries a mutation and who doesn't, you know? So it's really the multiplicity, the age, and, you know, multiple cancers that link together. Now, if there's, you know, a lot of lung cancer, but everybody's a heavy smoker, then that kind of thing, you know, look for the absence of other factors or other risk factors as well. And then rare tumors. So we talked about small intestinal cancer, but, you know, Li-Fraumeni syndrome, which Fred Lee described, there was a high risk of childhood brain tumors. Brain tumors are really unusual, and to get a brain tumor in a child is really unusual. So that should be a tip off, you know, for something that should be investigated further.
Thank you. We also had a pre-submitted question.
Can I give a shout out? I see Sarah Whitaker here, and Sarah has been wonderful at, she's really part of the team who is helping us launch that pilot that I was talking about for PREM in the electronic medical record at Dana-Farber. She's done a terrific job. Sorry, Sarah, I don't embarrass you, but.
Well deserved. We had a pre-submitted question. Could you speak to perhaps briefly where the field is at on a vaccine for Lynch syndrome, which as you mentioned, your presentation predisposes to a number of different types of cancers?
Yeah, there's a lot of work in this. If anybody's interested, I don't know who asked the question, if they attended, we have an annual conference for Lynch syndrome, and our keynote speaker this year, which I forget, we had to change the conference because of COVID. So I don't remember what month it was, but we did it virtually. And he spoke from Germany about the research into vaccines for Lynch syndrome. And he's really the leader in the field. And we can, maybe Angel, you and I can get back to the questioner and forward you the link to that lecture so you can hear all about it. But there's really, as I said, there's tremendous interest in vaccine development. And Lynch syndrome is certainly one of them. It gives me like a one thing that I want to pitch. You know, when Matthias Klora, this Dr. Klora spoke about the vaccines, I think what we've learned in the last year for me as a researcher is that when we all put our minds to beating something like COVID, like we've seen, you know, and everybody comes together to attack a problem and there's advocacy, and there's need, we can do it, you know? And I think that it's really been an amazing story about the vaccine development. I think for cancer prevention and cancer early detection, this is horrible. One of my friends is in the biotech world, and she says, you know, one of the things that's, and she said, you're not gonna like what I have to say, but what you do doesn't make anybody any money, you know? And it doesn't make any money because preventing a life, you know, preventing a cancer actually, you know, is the people who have the most vested interest in this are all of us and are the patients who are at risk and who are the providers. And I am convinced that the patients are really interested in this information, you know, and they will get genetic testing and they will find out about their risk and they will get the screening tests that are available to them. But we haven't really organized the advocacy around screening. You know, a lot of screening still isn't paid for by our healthcare system. And we need patients to say that this is something that they want. So I think we have to galvanize together. And this is part of this whole strategic thinking about early detection, you know, is that it can't only be about the science in an Ivy League tower like Harvard, you know. It has to be engaging with the community. It has to be engaging with policy, with government, to make this be at the forefront of everybody's mind, you know. So I think vaccine development will happen. I think we need a lot more funding and a lot more support for all of this work. You know, the National Cancer Institute, only a small proportion of their portfolio goes towards prevention or early detection approaches still. So I think we need to kind of shift that going forward.
And we also got a number of questions, and we just have another question here from Jane about what can folks do in terms of lifestyle, nutrition, diet to help support the prevention efforts and cancer interception efforts?
Yeah, it's a great question. Somebody was, Alice, did you have something to add to that question? Or no, that's, all right. It's a great question. I think we have really compelling data that body mass index or weight, you know, is really impacts cancer risk. And not only development of cancer, but even survival from cancer and the rates of recurrence. So keeping a normal weight is really essential. The same is true for exercise. I think that there are compelling data that aerobic activity, and don't ask me about how much and how often, because that we could go on forever, and there's lots of experts about that. But I think moderate physical activity on a regular basis is really been shown to have an impact on cancer, which is remarkable, independent of weight. The diet stuff, we've been less effective at figuring out, you know, and I think because dietary studies are hard to do, and I would do the same thing that we do for heart health, you know, which is, you know, to have a lower fat diet. It's all related ultimately to weight, but I think there's no right food or wrong food that's going to either cause you cancer or prevent you from cancer. But I think generally having healthy principles of diet are a good way. And then there's actually, you know, the other piece that we didn't talk about are things like aspirin has been shown to decrease rates of colon cancer. So there's a whole field that's looking at the use of what's called chemo prevention. So safe medications that can ultimately be used for prevention of cancer. That's a risk-benefit calculation. In Lynch syndrome, it's really been shown to be effective. So a lot of the times we talk to our Lynch syndrome patients, there's caveats to this, which I won't get into here, but there is, so those are the sort of general behavioral things. And then screening, you know, I think really making sure you're on top of your screening for breast cancer, for colon cancer. March is Colon Cancer Awareness Month. So if you need a colonoscopy and should be getting one, I know a lot of people are behind because of COVID. It's time to get back on schedule if you're over 50 or have a family history. So I think those are the main things, but I think, you know, it's exercise, it's weight and screening.
Wonderful. Well, we have many, many more questions. Unfortunately, we don't have time to get to all of them this evening, but we would be delighted to follow up with you at the end of the event. So anyway, I just wanted to thank everyone so much for this engaging discussion, for all of your thoughtful questions, for coming on camera. You know, we would love to be doing these events in person, but thank you for tuning in from the comfort of your home. We encourage you all to share the recording you will be receiving after the event with your networks and to continue tuning in to our future webinars. And if you have any additional questions or want to become more involved, you can reply to that follow-up email and someone from our office will be following up with you. So thank you so much for the many ways you have supported Dana-Farber, and I hope you all have a really nice evening.
Thank you, everybody. Bye-bye.